This is a presentation given at Armand Bayou Nature Center by Deanna Schmidt. Deanna is a researcher and urban designer with a professional background in landscape architecture and urban planning. She is also a former geography professor at the University of Houston, Clear Lake. Deanna is currently working in the planning department for the city of Pasadena, Texas.
So I really appreciate the opportunity to come and chat with you today. What I just want to talk a little bit about is my research, what I looked at and what I learned about the creation and the founding of Armand Bayou Nature Center. So I'll talk a little bit about that. And if there's questions or thoughts or anything, please stop me. I'm a school teacher by nature, a college school teacher, and I welcome hands going up. And I'll just say that many of you know a lot about Armand Bayou Nature Center. You've been here, you're committed to it, and I don't know everything. I'm more than happy. I want to learn too from what you all know. My story tonight talks about Hannah's suburban wilderness. You'll see that I have Armand Bayou Nature Center towards the bottom here because I want to talk about Hannah Ginsberg's role in the creation and founding of Armand Bayou. Okay, Armand Bayou Nature Center embodies the commitment of many people and organizations, countless volunteer hours, generous donations, committed public officials, nature's treasures on the garden on the Gulf Coast. But one woman stands out in the story of making Armand Bayou Nature Center, Hannah Ginsberg. The tragic death of Armand R. Montague in 1970 sparked the dream of Armand Bayou Nature Center, but Hannah is the one who brought it to fruition. So my talk is going to provide a little bit different perspective on Armand Bayou and its creation. So, let's see if I, oops, sorry. Okay, so a little bit about me. I conducted this research when I was a professor of geography at the University of Houston, Clear Lake, so just down the road. And where I came about this research because, of course, Armand Bayou Nature Center is in the backyard of Clear Lake, of UH Clear Lake. Maybe you can tell from my language, I'm not a Texan. I'm from Wisconsin. And so I landed my feet down here. I came down for the job at Clear Lake. I landed my feet here. And there was this beautiful place called Armand Bayou Nature Center right here. I was fascinated. It was one of the most important things that I learned about early on was this place. This place is such a gem throughout the greater Houston region. And so one of the first things I really wanted to do was understand what this place was and how it got to be here. So my talk here is a little piece of some of my research. And answering my first question, how did this place come to be? And so I'm going to give you a little bit of my take on that. I conducted research mostly in the University of Houston, Clear Lake, University of Houston main campus's archives. There's some wonderful archives, so a lot of my work is coming from there. And this is why I want to begin with Hannah. And a picture of from Armand Bayou. This is from her own papers. Governments don't initiate. If you want a project, individuals have to start it. For me, this was who Hannah was. She didn't wait for somebody else to make something happen, to get something done. She just decided that this is what needed to be done, and she did it. And so she's an inspiration to me. That's why I begin there. So this place, I'm a geographer, so I'm going to have to give you a little bit of geography here. So you have to bear with me. One of the terms that geographers love is place. And I talked about how, as a place, Armand Bayou fascinated me when I first came down. And I wanted to understand how people create places. How do people come to understand what a place is and create a place like Armand Bayou? So Armand Air Montague was the spark, but I think of Hannah Ginsberg as really the light and the vision. That's why I called it my talk, Hannah's Suburban Wilderness. Because she's the one that was really the vision as I see it. This was a letter from Terry Hershey. Some of you may have heard of Terry Hershey. Terry Hershey was one of the early leaders of the Bayou Preservation Association, Buffalo Bayou Preservation. She and Hannah are the two grand dames of environment here in Houston. And so she wrote a letter to Lady Bird Johnson in 1972, and she says, "I'm confident that Mrs. Ginsberg can bring it up." She's saying, bring off Armand Bayou, this creation of a nature center. "If we lose Armand Bayou, we will bury Miss Ginsberg. We can ill afford to lose her kind any more than we can lose Armand's Bayou." To me, that kind of sums up this whole story and the commitment and the vision that Hannah had to create Armand Bayou's nature center. So this is an old USGS map of Armand Bayou. Well, I should say Middle Bayou, because this is an old USGS map, and I'm a geographer, so I love maps, 1920, showing Armand Bayou. And it was called Middle Bayou. It was called Middle Bayou before 1970 and before the process of creating the place, Armand Bayou Nature Center. So what this is showing you is Clear Lake, Mud Lake, though I should say in Pasadena, we call that Pasadena Lake. You go a little bit north. Middle Bayou, which starts up in Golden Acres of in the city of Pasadena and winds its way down to Clear Lake. So this kind of just gives you an idea. Once again, I'm working on this idea of how places happen. A little bit on my geographic perspective, you just have to bear with me because this is what I do. In understanding this place of Armand Bayou Nature Center, I'm taking this from three different perspectives. I'm kind of using three tools. Looking at the human-environment interaction. So how do people shape the environment, and how does the environment shape people? So thinking about that interaction, and then connections. Geographers love to understand connections between different places and different people. For example, come back up here. Terry Hershey, letter to Lady Bird Johnson in 1972. Connections between different places and different people, and how those different connections are coming together to create a unique place like Armand Bayou Nature Center. So I'm interested in these connections. And there's one thing about geography that I really love is that it's really interdisciplinary. So I don't come at this from just a social scientist side or from just history. I look at this from the environmental side, from the soil side, from all these different kinds of perspectives. Geographers work across a lot of different disciplines. So as I'm talking about this, I'm just trying to give you a little framework to where I'm going here. I think about place as a place like Armand Bayou as weaving together these different threads and connections. So thinking about how Armand Bayou is a web or a weaving of different places and different people, coming together to create this really unique place called Armin Bayou Nature Center. Am I just totally not making any sense here? So I'm going to start off just kind of weaving this together a little bit. I want to talk about the West Ranch, oil and gas development, flooding, rapid urban development, and then the environmental movement. So this is kind of setting the context for Hannah's work in being the vision of Armin Bayou. She's kind of working with these different threads to help bring together different people to create this place called Armin Bayou. But once again, we have to start talking. I need to kind of talk about this human-environment interaction. So we have to talk about flooding. We need to talk about oil and gas in this story. We need to talk about how these different pieces are coming together to create Armin Bayou Nature Center. So this is the West Ranch. Anybody familiar with the West Ranch? Yeah, there's plenty of different, I'm in the planning department at Pasadena, so we see all kinds of different proposals come forward for remaking the West Ranch Mansion and stuff, yeah. So it's always interesting. So the West Ranch, anybody have any thoughts what this would have to do with thinking about creating the place Armin Bayou Nature Center? Why would this be an important thread, I guess? Any thoughts?
It probably unified the area. I mean, a powerful, controversial figure.
I think you're kind of getting at this, right? It brought together this huge parcel of land. And it's very unusual. So Jim West, amassed a big ranch. About some 30,000 acres here on the south side. And that's my approximate boundaries of the West Ranch. So it was a big patch of land under one ownership. So this sets an interesting context to understand how the area developed, right? So the West Ranch. And this is a little bit more modern picture of the mansion, a little bit older picture. But I want to just kind of point out how the shape here, keep your eye kind of on the shape of this relative shape here, and there's a little piece that extends out even to Galveston Bay. So this is kind of an important starting point to think about.
She's a pointer on that, right?
Oh. Oh, look at that. Sorry. Okay. Oh, yeah. How handy. Okay. So thinking about this area, and if you look here, that became Bayport Industrial. That became the port. So all of this whole region was under the ranch. So what that means is not only was it under all one ownership, and that has ramifications for how it developed over time, but this was ranch land, right? And it also became fairly early on oil and gas land. So we have the West Ranch under one ownership to begin with. And this is another piece, kind of this environmental interaction. So I know that this isn't the best kind of map to show. Okay, so this, I'm going around 610. If you kind of see that, and then the beltway is way out here. So what this map is showing us is where, and then there's Harris County, where the bigger oil fields are. And that's what these are. That's what we're showing here. These are the locations of the bigger oil fields, and underneath those are the salt domes. So what I'm getting at here is thinking about how the oil and gas piece falls into here. So we have, actually, Clear Lake is down here, And this is the Clear Lake oil field. And then over here is the Friendswood or the Webster oil field. So this region, like much of the region, is major oil fields. So your backyard is one of the biggest oil fields on the southeast Texas coast. It isn't so much anymore, but come the late, early 1930s, it was. And what we had intersecting here was the West Ranch and Humble Oil, the Humble Oil Company, found oil right here in Clear Lake under this big salt dome. And they wanted to pump that oil. And in order to do that, Jim West said, no, we're not going to allow you, I won't allow you to do that unless you buy the whole ranch. So Humble Oil Company bought the whole ranch, the whole 30,000 acres, in order to develop this oil field. So one thing, and that was in 1938. So 1938, Humble Oil Company bought, and bought the West Ranch, this entire region, in order to develop the Clear Lake oil field. Any questions about that? So that left Humble Oil Company, which is today Exxon, with a huge chunk of land and a great oil field. There isn't much oil and gas development here anymore. However, and this is a contemporary map, the Friendswood oil field is still heavily pumped right here. So let me orientate you. This is 45 right here, the Gulf Freeway. And on either side of the freeway, that's a big oil field. What you're looking at, this is the Texas Railroad Commission map. And what you're looking at are oil fields, oil wells, and gas wells. And then here's Clear Lake up here. There's a few active oil wells in here, but not very much. And then, of course, here is Armand Bayou, just to kind of orientate yourself. So when I'm trying to pull together these different threads of Armand Bayou and what makes this place, a key part of understanding this is this intermix of the oil and gas very close and tied into the development of Armand Bayou. The Clear Lake oil field was here for a long time. And it still is with us today. Subsidence, flooding is my next part here. What, can anybody tell me anything about the subsidence story?
When the land shifts and you get depressions and
depression?
The elevation is reduced, then it's more susceptible to floods.
Mm-hmm. It is, yeah. So the land is actually sinking. Yeah.
And you don't own the elevation under our homes.
You don't own the elevation.
Not in Houston.
Yeah, and you don't own any of the oil and gas underneath your homes either. It's not yours. So this is the story of another important thread here in Armand Bayou. And where I'm going here is kind of thinking about subsidence. Subsidence has been caused since the 1950s, 1960s in this region by the pumping of oil and gas and water wells too. We basically don't pump any of our water that we drink from wells. We have them for backup here in the southeast Houston region, but 90% of our water, our daily water, is coming from the big reservoirs, Lake Houston, Lake Conroe. So, and part of the reason why is not that we don't have good water underneath our feet, it's just that we don't want to sink anymore by pumping that water out. So, what has happened since the 1950s and 60s, this is downtown Houston right here. This entire region has sunk since the 1950s and 60s between 6 feet up to 10 feet in this entire region. Now think about it. If we had another 6 feet of elevation during this last storm.
Yeah. Would have been nice.
Yes. So this is why subsidence is a very crucial story here. Fortunately, we don't pump any more water, and very little oil and gas is coming out of the ground in this region, so subsidence isn't nearly as big as a problem as it was. We've learned to understand these processes. But this was a pretty big wake-up call, you can imagine, in the 1950s and 60s. And why might this subsidence be important to talk about with Armin Bayou?
Flood control.
Flood control. Right. So one of the important parts of Hanna's work was to explain to people that if we protect the wetlands, the green spaces, that we could reduce flooding. So the flooding issues were an important part of this process of creating Armin Bayou Nature Center. This is Armin Bayou in 1953 and Armin Bayou in 2002. I took this is from my paper. But you can kind of see up here, this is the same area, and you can look how the bayou is curly-cueing around, and then look at the same area in 2002. What has happened is the entire land has sunk and flooded the shore. So Armin Bayou took on a much, much bigger bank. And this was mostly due to the subsidence issues. But it became an important selling point for helping to support the reasoning behind Armin Bayou Nature Center. This was also an important time period. Anybody have flood insurance? Good. 1968, that federal legislation was passed, and this area was one of the first targeted areas for the federal government to target flood insurance. So Baytown was an early community to sign up for the flood insurance program. Each one of your communities, including Pasadena, sign up for the flood insurance program. And the more good things we do to reduce flooding in the community, the lower your interest rate premiums are. There's a direct link there. So all of that rollout was happening at the same time that Armin Bayou was coming together. It's another one of these connections and weavings that I'm trying to explain, is that the National Flood Insurance Program began in 1968, and really Hanna was working in the early 1970s, and one of the things that she worked with was explaining these flooding connections, how protecting the wetlands and how protecting green spaces are an excellent way to reduce flooding. Back to the West Branch. Doesn't quite look like the West Branch, right? This is, so what happens when a big oil company buys a 30,000 acre property, 30,000 acres, on Southeast Texas? What happens when they have one little area is an oil field, and then most of the rest of it is not? What does an oil company they develop. So Humble Oil Company, which became Exxon, created the Friendswood Development Company. And this is the original plan for Clear Lake in 1962. This was the first original plan. So you can see Bayport was in the early plans in 1962. You can see Armin Bayou right here. This is approximately Bay Area Boulevard and Space Center in here. That was shown as a town hall center, and then residential all the way around. and then this would have been the industrial area. So, what do you see in here? It tells you anything about open space and green space, 1962.
Yeah, it is.
So this was a pretty much a clarion call, right? We have flooding issues. We need to begin to deal with protecting our open space. And this is, I mean, actually, this was also about the time the woodlands were being developed too. So there was greater environmental awareness in the 1960s. So people are becoming more interested in the environment, but you can see that the company, the Friendswood Development Company, planned to develop pretty much right up to the banks of Armin Bayou. Not totally. I mean, they were leaving some nice green space. I'm going back here. Clear Lake City, just some of the early housing. NASA. NASA was an important piece, an important thread in here too. So the Manned Space Center brought a couple things to this story. It brought people, educated people, people that were interested in quality of life, and this became an important center for economic development in the region. And for people that would be interested in experiencing a place like Armin Bayou. And it also, sorry, my picture slid up, set the course between a conflict between increased economic development and more houses, more businesses, more roads, and the environmental qualities of this region. So one of the other stories here is thinking about the loss of the natural area, the loss of the ranch land, the loss of having the wide open spaces to new development. And so this is Terry Hershey, and she just recently passed away. Her and Hannah were key instrumental people in the process of creating Armin Bayou Nature Center. And I just put this up to just point out that the 1960s were an important part of the story in thinking about understanding the protection of the environment, the environmental movement, and how people became much more interested in the environment as a place for learning, as a place for health, as a place for recreation. And so this is another one of those threads. And there's Hannah's. And she's really the vision. She kind of brought all of these different pieces together. One of the pieces that needed to come together was thinking about the how we finance and create something like this. So I'll talk just briefly a little bit about how the different parcels of land, actually the Armin Bayou Nature Center was purchased as a series of different parcels of land over time and with many different funding sources. So I just kind of want to talk about, once again, some of these other threads and important pieces. One of the important pieces of funding the Armin Bayou Nature Center was HUD, the Department of Housing and Urban Development, the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development's program called the Legacy Parks Program, which was a relatively short-term program, federal program, but its goal was to put green space and environmental spaces in urban areas, parks in urban areas. And this wasn't a very important piece to the Armin Bayou Nature Center story. So here's a connection, a federal program that is actually helping the city of Pasadena to purchase the first big parcel, almost 1,000 acres, that became Armand Bayou Nature Center. So with this program, the Legacy Parks program, the city of Pasadena was able to use that funding, that grant funding, in order to purchase land from the Friendswood Development Company. So let me just go back. So this first parcel of land, which was down here on off the bayou, that the grant program was able to allow the city of Pasadena to purchase that parcel, purchase those parcels. Why Pasadena? Any thoughts about that?
Flooding was
an issue, and there was several neighborhoods in Pasadena that were having flooding problems. Do you know what they wanted to do with that, to solve their flooding problem, though?
Channelize.
They wanted to dig up and clean out the bayou so the water would run faster. So that took some leaps, but Pasadena backed down on that. But this was one of the things that Hannah had to begin to teach people about, that wetlands are excellent flood control tools, that they can help flood control. And so that's kind of part of that learning process. Any other thoughts? Why Pasadena?
Is it Borders Bayou?
Yeah.
Borders Bayou, yeah.
The politicians in Pasadena were also linked to the Friendswood Development Company, so they wanted to use public money to cover their loss from buying a land.
I couldn't disprove or prove the connection between politicians and the Friendswood Development Company. And I can't speak to that. but I will tell you that the Friendswood Development Company did not want to sell this land. They really didn't. The development company, and this is one thing I do know, they want to build houses. And that's where they really make their money. Developers don't make their big money on just selling land. Most of the developers make their big money by actually building houses and building things. So Friendswood Development Company wanted to build stuff here. But with the flooding problems that were coming up, and with the new National Flood Insurance Program, the planning department, some people, the politicians in Pasadena began to see some light there. And they did prevent the Friendswood Development Company from building anything, I think it was below 15-foot elevation. So that created a whole parcel of land that was unbuildable for the Friendswood Development Company. When the city of Pasadena put in new regulations, new building regulations. So there was a piece of property that they were okay to get rid of, so to speak. And the Friendswood Development Company, like many development companies, were also very interested in having good PR. They sell buildings, they sell houses. They don't want to be bad community people, right? They're in the business of making money. So most developers will do anything to not have a bad image out there. That's not what they do. So they're willing. They were more than willing to sell some property, but just that low property. Yeah.
Isn't it true that Pasadena almost represented development of fractals, the way they made their borders so that they would maximize the area for industrial park growth, which generated huge sums of money.
Well, Pasadena's borders our city borders are not generally done too strategically anymore. And certainly, I think Houston had a pretty active annexation program, but Pasadena never had a real active annexation program. What Pasadena did, and this might be where you're coming from, is that Pasadena has a pretty large industrial district. So everything east of Red Bluff is in Pasadena's industrial district. It's not in the city. And there's a good reason for that, that the city wants to keep all the big industry out of the city. The industry likes to be out of the city. That means I don't have to regulate their land development. They still have to be regulated for their pollution, air and water pollution, but I don't have to tell them how much parking they need to do or how they need to treat their wastewater. So there's these big industrial districts in Pasadena that's happening, and the city likes to keep those two things separate. So I don't know if they have strategic different places, but out in the industrial district, some of the owners, when they develop out in the industrial district, they want to be annexed because they prefer to be on city water and sewer. So it gets to be kind of a funky hodgepodge. I'd be happy to talk for hours about that. Okay, one other thing. I was gonna, any other thoughts about why Pasadena get this HUD funding?
There's a lot of guess.
Yeah.
Perhaps the cities that are now very famous to us all were not very well developed. We didn't have real functional government, and Pasadena did.
It could be, but Deer Park, La Porte, they're all kind of, Pasadena's always been a little bit bigger in population size, but they're all about the same kind of animal, I think, in a lot of different ways. Pasadena was bigger in many ways, so it had a few more resources to play with. And Pasadena really didn't have hardly any parks. And this was at this cusp of this environmental movement, and there was some interest in doing more for parks and making this a better place. I hate this, but Stinkadena. and so I think there was people that were interested in making this a better place, thinking about parks, improving the quality of life. And Pasadena did have some of the resources, and there was people there that were interested in this. And I'll go back to Andy Helms and Mayor Doyle at the time believed with Hanna that this is something important, that Armond Bayou needed to be saved. So it kind of makes sense. Pasadena had enough of the resources. They had the people. People are important. I began in talking about this, how important it is for the people to make this, all these pieces come together. And we didn't have much for parks. So Mann Space Center, the environmental movement, there's Hanna. And just briefly, another important thread here that I just want to talk just briefly was the state of Texas and the Bureau of Outdoor Recreation and Harris County. Harris County, of course, owns this land now. And Armond Bayou Nature Center just has a 99-year lease, but it's renewable. And so the other piece of this thread is Harris County really stepping up to purchase land themselves and work with the Bureau of Outdoor Recreation in order to do that. So another piece of this puzzle is the role of Harris County and their leadership in order to become the land owner for this area. And then private donations were another important piece. Armond Bayou, I'm sorry this is all a little bit screwy, but Armond Bayou part dedication in 1972. This is Mayor Clyde Doyle, and he was a supporter of Armand Bayou. And he, once you have the mayor behind you, and Hannah did, things can happen. And this is U.S. Senator John Tower at the dedication ceremony in 1972. So this would have been right after the Legacy Parks program grant funding came through and the purchase of that first parcel. This is where Friendswood Development Company had planned Clear Lake Forest. I know it's kind of hard to see, but those were the proposed roadway layouts. And you all are approximately right there. So Friendswood Development Company had big plans. This is a map that came from Hannah's papers, and it's another way of looking at the subsidence. And I'm sharing this with you to show how part of the role that Hannah did was to explain subsidence to people so that they understood the importance of saving wetlands. So this is just kind of another way of looking. This is 1956 in the bayou, and this is after subsidence and how the bayou looked. This is a map that's looking at the land acquisition programs and how the different parcels were purchased. This was, and to tell you the truth, some of you might have a better handle of this than I do. But this was the land acquisition program and how the different pieces of the Nature Center was coming together. Okay. One of the important parts of the work, and I started off my talk looking at how governments don't do it, people have to do it. One of the important things that was happening was PR, getting the word out and letting people know about Armand Bayou. Pasadena to seek funds for Armand Bayou plan, a chance to help. The historic papers were full of these news articles and similar to this, promoting Armand Bayou. An important link here is Harold Scarlett, and he was a Houston Post environmental writer, and he was pretty much a mouthpiece for Hannah. So what you can see here is a promotion of Armand Bayou and a chance to help. And this is an important piece too. Thinking about these threads again, it's kind of a good place to kind of think about it as we get into the holiday seasons. The Creature Christmas List was a promotional piece that Hannah and supporters of Armand Bayou put together in order to raise funds and raise awareness of Armand Bayou. So that's what this is, and I'll just read it for you. Armand Bayou Creature Christmas List. $5 saves my lily pond, $10 saves my nest, $20 saves our holy homes, $50 saves the rest, $100 gives me room to roam, $500 saves our pond, $1,000 helps to build the path that children walk upon. So this is the Creature Christmas List. It was published in the Houston Post in 1972. I think this kind of says a lot about the feeling and what was important and the founding and the early promotion of Armand Bayou. So thinking about the creatures, the children, and this is a map that I kind of put together today. Recently, and so Armand Bayou Nature Center And to me, this really sums up, it brings me back to when I first landed here, kind of, well, Wisconsin is kind of landing on the moon, just so you know. Just so you know. And it's kind of, and so I landed here, and there was this gem of Harmon Bayou Nature Center. In the midst of all these subdivisions and industries, I can, the first time we drove down, we came across the big ship channel bridge, and I was like, oh my God.
Where am I?
When was that? 2009.
Not too far away.
Harmon Bayou Nature Center was this island really in the middle of all of this suburb and city, and it's just such a gem. And so that's what I was kind of trying to show there. So that's my little